Well, thank you very much. So this is the title of my book, and you are going to be the test audience for the synopsis of my book. So what I've done now is I've taken the subjects in the order I'm going to talk about them and put them into a slide. I'm not going to read you the entire book, but I'm going to tell you the story in a lecture form, so in a shorter way. And I would really much like for you afterwards to tell me if this order is good for the book or if you think I should change anything. But you will also be getting a really nice story, so I hope you enjoy it. So, first of all, this machine is arguably the first series produced Danish microcomputer. But the predecessor to it, the prototype, is undoubtedly the first Danish microcomputer ever. So that was a bit about who did what first, and if you announce the computer before you produce it, who wins and stuff like that. So I choose to call this the first Danish microcomputer, and I have like 50 kilos of arguments for that back in my office because I have collected a lot of material. This is most likely the most well-prepared talk you'll hear this year. I have been studying for this for almost 4 years. So, and when I started researching about this computer, I was expecting it to be an article, a really short thing, maybe a Wikipedia thing. And then I started digging, and suddenly it all blew up in my head. And I was taken back to 1972, where this Danish dude by the name Børge, I'm so sorry, he died before we could take a good picture of him. Børge Rosgaard Christensen, nice last name, was an associate professor in Tønder College of Education. That is a Danish school where they train teachers for like the rest of the country. It's not the only of its kind, but it's one of them. He was an eager and insisting advocate for proper computer science teaching in Denmark. So he's famous for saying that basic should be illegal. He was extremely productive author. I have 12 books by his name, and that's only the 12 I succeeded to get my hands on. He was a language geek. I don't know if you know about the language Interlingua. You most likely know about Esperanto. Interlingua is, don't quote me on this, but more or less the same. So they're trying to make an international language without any exceptions. So if you know the grammar rules, those will always apply. And he spent 20 years of his life as a board member for the committee developing this language. So it's safe to say that A, that dude likes rules, and B, that dude likes languages. So that's a bit about him. Back in 71, his institution got a data general computer called Nova 1200. This was a machine sold by Regnecentralen under a different name, but in essence, this was a data general machine. He started teaching on it, and he started teaching his students BASIC. And if any of you know how to program BASIC, you know that it's fine as long as all the lines of code can be on the screen. As soon as you reach line number 25, it starts becoming chaos. So he complained a lot about this. And around the spring of 72, he met this computer scientist in Aarhus called Benedikt Løfstedt. And together with him, they started formulating this new language, which should be a combination of Pascal and BASIC. And this Børge dude is very talkative and very convincing and has like the energy of a nuclear bomb. So I'm sure he just overwhelmed Regnecentralen with good intentions and with questions and with interest, because sometime during the first half of 1972, they actually gave him the source code for the BASIC they used on their systems. He hired some student workers and got those student workers to change this BASIC into a COMEL. So one of the main differences is that COMEL go-to is like prohibited. So it's not, but in essence, you shouldn't use it. So you have function calls and procedure calls, and it's a more structured language. So they turned this old BASIC into a more structured BASIC. And in the beginning, they actually called it RC BASIC, Regnecentralen BASIC. But soon they changed the name to COMEL, which is short for Common... I should have written this down. Common... Did I write? Yeah, of course I did write that. Common Algorithmic Language. I did write it down. Thank you. And then he used his position as a teacher. So you know, he teaches the teachers to influence the teachers to that they should use COMEL, which is super awesome because during the last part of the 70s, suddenly it became a standard demand from schools. Oh, by the way, your computer doesn't run COMEL. We don't want it, but it's better and cheaper. It doesn't run COMEL. So he kind of forced everybody to implement COMEL in order to get sold their systems to the Danish schools. We got a story from the head of the data department on Odense College of Education, where he called the guy the 26th of December and said, "Oh, can I come by? I need to show you something. We're really busy. We have this family thing, you know." And okay, tomorrow then. So during the Christmas holiday, he influenced his colleague at the next College of Education to start using COMEL as well, and he succeeded in just one day. He gave some guest lectures in Germany, West Germany, and he got it spread to most of Europe just by being really energetic and talking about it. And down the road, they actually managed to sell this idea to Commodore. And during the 80s, Commodore made a version, the best ever, and they sold it in the entire world. And actually, it has been taught as they are the biggest user group of COMEL in general is American. So and we have like 2,400 pages of their user magazine, which is a huge source of information. And finally, he used the University Center of Southern Jutland to fund lots of his work. So this is not a real university. It was like, so in Southern Jutland, they asked the government for a university. And during, I don't remember it exactly, but around 72-73, the government said, yes, you can have a university in 2 years. So the local municipality said, cool, we'll just get started. And they funded the startup of it themselves. And after 2 years, the government was just like, nah, we're good. And so they just kept funding it themselves. So it's not a real university, but for all practical purposes, it is. They had... they had some money which they could use for research, and Børge Christensen got paid some money to develop COMEL. And later on, he got this crazy idea that I'll talk more about in a little bit, because we need to travel back in time again. Now we're back in 77, where this dude called Mogens Pelle, he finished his degree of electrical engineering in 73, and has been writing technical instructions, build guides for... You know, back then, when you were a geek, you didn't have the internet, so you bought these things out of paper called magazines, and there was basically a large block, and he wrote guides on to build different stuff for this block. Oh, well, mostly he read guides from international magazines, translated them to Danish, and republished them. But and that is so many years ago that it's probably not, I don't know, if it's probably still illegal, but... And it was a bit sketchy. Anyway, but that was what he did. And he used this platform to, when he got access to a Xilog Z80 processor, as one of the first in Denmark, he used the platform from this magazine to start publishing schematics for a computer that he designed, and started a movement of data machine amateurs, he called them. They were in several global Danish medias, and he got a really a lot of press on that. So he founded a company down here, Metanic APS, and started selling PCBs. And in the beginning, he only wanted to sell PCBs. But then suddenly, a guy from this Southern University Center wrote him and said, "I read your article about that computer. I want to buy one." And he was just like, we don't sell them, but I want to buy one. You can build one. I don't want to buy one. I want to buy one. So he built one and sold to that guy, and that guy was Mikkel Christensen. That escalated, but before we get to that, I just want to mention the users that started building this machine also founded a user group, and they actually produced the MPS 2000 user group magazine for about a year, which is also one of the great sources we have for these stories. I forgot to mention in the beginning, but all this information is something I have dug out from either interviews or old magazines, or like there's no history book about this. This is what I'm writing. So I have been through old archives, through old reading 30-year-old newspapers and accountings, and it's been a really like investigative journalism with 40 years of delay. Anyway, let's get back to the Southern University Center. So in 72, decided that we need some of this. In Danish, we set EDB, which stands for Electronic Data Behandling Processing, which is, you can translate it today with IT, information technology. But they founded the EDB Council. And the idea with the EDB Council was that they should build a data center in Esbjerg, which is one of the most... if you leave towards Jutland now and just keep driving west, you'll end up in Esbjerg. That's one of the most... I don't know if they still do fishing, but it's a big harbor city. They were promised that by 75 they would get funding for both the university and for the data center. And as you might already spotted, if you read ahead, that was denied. So this is transformed into a general coordination council, which would coordinate the educational institutions in the municipality and help them avoid wasting money on this computer stuff. And then in 77, Mogens Pelle discovered, Børge Christensen discovered Mogens Pelle and bought this computer from him. And then the Southern University Center more or less took over the project. So if you read Børsen is a Danish newspaper for business interested people, or Jyllandsposten, which is all the major newspapers. They talked about this machine and they called it the SUC computer. And it was called the people's computer because it was built to be cheap and was built, you could freely build it yourself. And the idea was that you wanted to provide ordinary people with computers, which is something, that was an idea that got very popular like 10, 15 years later, mainly by pushed by a guy named Bill Gates. So they were a bit ahead, but yeah. So the idea was that the SUC funded this prototype, which Børge Christensen then bought from Mogens Pelle, and then he was like, I need some software for it. So he also got some money to develop some software. If you read in 1979, when this machine was about to be published, everybody said that this was supposed to be sold under the name of SUC Datamaten. It didn't happen like that, but... Then I'm going to jump a bit again because I need some more, what do you call that, prehistory? What's that, prehistory? Background history? So I mentioned that this Comet thing got that popular that school just said, we need this. And then 1.5 months ago, a dude in Jutland died. And one of his friends called me because he knew that I might be interested in some of his old computers. I'm really sad he didn't call me half a year ago before he died, but yeah, you can't win every time. However, this guy worked in Ribe County or Ribe Amt, Department for Purchasing Educational Materials. So back in 78, they founded this committee and said, Ribe Amt needs to buy some computers for education. So they requested Regnestyrelsen, which is the Danish version of ICL, and the requested ICL, which is the British version of Regnecentral. Data General and some other large manufacturers, and also they visited some of them. So they flew to Copenhagen and to Great Britain and saw some of these machines in use. And at this point, we were talking about, so the committee said, we want Comal and we want microcomputers. Do I need to tell you? Probably I do. So back in the back before the PCs, when we talked about computers, a computer would typically be a system that would require its own building. And a mini computer would be a computer that you could fit inside one or two small closets. And a microcomputer would be something like this that you could have, this one that you could have on your own desk. So this was a microcomputer. What you would probably call a computer back then, we would most likely call that a data center, because that is at least five or six racks of equipment and readers and really, really huge. And it would be some of the offers they got were for 1.5 million krones divided by 7 for euros. So Regnecentralen said, well, we hear you. You want Comal? We can do that. You want a microcomputer? Well, you can have a mainframe. ICL was like, well, Comal, no, we have this obscure thing we made ourselves that nobody likes, and a mainframe. So RCA said, well, by the way, we found this guy called Mons Pelle and Børge Christensen, and they are building this computer, and now we are selling that for them. They said that in the fall of 1979, and only 2 weeks later, Regnecentralen went back and said, no, by the way, we don't want to sell that anyway, but we are going to build our own microcomputer, which will cost the same as a mainframe, but can only be used by one person. So that was a really good offer. Surprisingly, like 14 days. No, actually, I got the two messages from so-called Telex, which was the email of the day, and there are hours in difference from when they received the message from Regnecentralen and the message from ICL. So it was either it was the same day or the day after. So very, very close, ICL comes back and say, now we sell the computer that Mogens Pelle and Børge Christensen is selling. So that's a bit back and forth. But all in all, it ended up that ICL would be the computer, be the manufacturing company who sold this machine. So we started with this company called Metanic. It's right here. And if you notice, it's probably now I need to mention that Børge Christensen is not on this picture. Børge Christensen really did not want to be a part of the public story because he was just like this, a bit of a hippie type, and commercial companies were a bit yucky. And actually, Børsen wrote that Børge Christensen was part of that. And I think 1 or 2 days later, there was a message in Børsen saying, oh, we didn't mean that, it was a mistake. And I mean, they don't do that by themselves. Somebody called them and yelled at them for saying it. So I'm sure he was very eager by not getting commercially associated with this project, because he wanted to use his contacts in academia without him being accused of wanting to make a buck on it. That's my theory. I can't prove it because the guy is dead. But I have a lot of indicia for that. What is that called? So, you know, not circumstantial evidence that points to that, yeah. Okay, so I put Regnecentralen in there because, a lot of people mistakes this and thinks that Regnecentralen made this computer. And that is wrong, but it could have been true. And that's fun. That's a fun fact, I think. So in Horsens, and I'm probably going to make a whole chapter about this in the book alone. In Horsens, back in the 70s, there was this huge television factory. Actually, it started out like a bicycle factory. They also did chemicals and lots of other stuff. But they had a department for building televisions and radios, which burned down in the late 60s, like 69, I think, 70, around there. All these details will, of course, be in the book, by the books. There's a link in the bottom of the slides. This burned down, so this was a Dutch or a British company, a trans-European company decided to enter this factory and fund the rebuilding of it, and they went bankrupt in 1975. And then they had like I think 400 workers in this part of the company, and they was just like, well, if this international company can do this, sure, we can do it ourselves. So they decided to buy the production line of the estate. Can you say that about a company? I'm not sure. Anyway, so they took over the company. This was a huge story. They got the municipality to pay some of it, a lot of it. They made like stocks you could sell to, or it's called the people stocks, Folkeaktier. So it was a huge deal with publicity and stuffs. And only 2 years later, the Hungarian government, which was communist by the time, bought the majority of the shares in the company and kept it afloat until 1979. But the vibe of the People's Television Factory was still there, and they tried to use that to market the computer as the People's Computer. But it didn't go. 3F went bankrupt, and they went bankrupt like months before they had promised to deliver these machines. And there are a couple of machines who was built at this point, but we don't know who built them. I have talked to Mons Pelle, and he don't remember what he had for breakfast last day. So that's, by the way, that's his own words. I'm not mugging him anyway. He's really has a bad memory. So we're trying to jolt his memory by showing him, yeah, everything I come up with, I send to him, and he's, oh yeah, I remember that. And then slowly we get the memories back from him. But he don't recall where these machines were built. The best I got from him was like that, oh yeah, I might have built them myself. Which is possible, because we are talking about somewhere between 30 and 50 machines. You can build that in a couple of months, maybe hire a couple of young ones to help you. So it's we have another example of a young guy who built 400 machines with his wife at the kitchen table and sold them to institutions in all Finland. So it has happened before, so it could have happened. So they shipped these machines off to another factory they found in Northern Zealand, which started the production. And that ended up being what was called the ICL Comet MPS 2000. And just to put Komal back in there, then the same company who built the machine actually started developing the first version of Komal for the Z80-based machines. So we still have Komal tagging in here, and Metanic was designing the hardware, but not building it. But he was also designing the software. So this Mons Pelle dude was trying to be the intellectual master without having to do the actual work, which in theory was a good idea, only in theory. So the machine, we think there were made about 200 of them, running with the Xilinx Z80 CPU at 1 MHz and 4 KB of memory, and they used a tape. Do you remember these small tapes from we used in the 90s for voice answering machines, or for those you know, the doctor would speak into a thing to make notes, a dictaphone? Do you remember those? They used those for data. They could cram 128 kilobytes of data into one of these machines. Impressive. And they lived happily ever after. Of course they didn't. Because you have this is IT, you have to have people not liking each other. So I'm going to talk a bit about 88 Electronic, which was the company who took over the production of the machines. This company was founded in 1976, and it didn't stop in 1980, but that's where I'm stopping for this chapter. So the company was founded by a young engineer. Actually, they sprung out of a company who made gas systems, so like regulators and stuff like that. And the boss of that company asked him to say, can you develop a process control system for us? And he was just like, yeah, I can do that. So he also got his hand on a Z80 processor and built a Z80-based process control platform. And in 1978, he announced in Børsen, again, the same magazine as we talked about before, that he had developed a version of BASIC, which were more structured than BASIC, and called it 88 BASIC. And a news like that, you can publish that in a local, in a global Danish, what is it called, in a countrywide Danish paper without Børge Christensen noticing. So in 1978, Børge Christensen called ACS Electronic and got to talk with them about their BASIC. So that was how the connection was made. Actually, it was in 1979. It says here, so probably right. So this machine wasn't really usable, mainly because it took 20 minutes to load the tape with 128 kilobytes of memory of program. So imagine you're having a class and you need to teach them COMAL, and you got four machines, and each machine, there are four students around each machine, and they start at 8 o'clock with loading the tape, and you wait 20 minutes, and then two of the machines breaks down and needs to be restarted. So now the class is over. That wasn't, they didn't like that. Jørgen Høgh went to ICL and said, you know what, I like this idea with these computers, but I don't like this Mogens Pelle dude. So either I'm leaving and you can keep your system, or we are going to make a new computer based on our process control system, and Mogens Pelle is leaving. And ICL had at this point been fighting for almost 2 years to find a factory that could produce these machines. So ICL was just like, well, are we going with the guy who had all these crazy ideas and couldn't put them into life, or with this guy who actually put these crazy ideas into reality, but now want to scale a little bit back? So they, of course, went with HH Electronic, and they developed the MPS 3000, and MPS 2000 was dropped or phased out slowly. A funny story about this was that nobody remembered to tell Mogens Pelle that, so he didn't know until around 1980, the spring 1980, where he went to this factory and wanted to pick up his check. So how many computers have you made, and can I please have my check? And he was just like, we didn't make any computers, you can't have any check, we are doing it ourselves now. So that's not a good way it could have been done smarter. More about that during the next slide. They made this machine, and this is what most Danish guys in my dad's age would probably have seen in the school. That would be this orange case made out of 1.5 millimeter plate, steel plate. Today you would probably not be allowed to move this by the government because health and safety risks. It's really, really heavy, and its power supply you don't touch the cabinet on the back when it's turned on, you'll burn because it's really, really, really hot. Anyway, the machines become very popular, and overall, there were produced about 3,000 units of these machines. Nothing much to say about that. It was a new beginning. But Mogens Pelle was just like, no, hell no, I don't want to be part of this, and they're not going to screw me over. So he made a new computer. He made the MPS 2001. So now you see what's happening is we have this first computer, and now it's forking out into two different machines. Which one is the following? Which one is number two, if any? If you take this machine apart, on the motherboard, you will actually see it's called MPS 2001. However, that's the only place you will see that, because he partnered up with a bunch of young salesmen from the Midtjylland. And those guys could sell. So he built this machine, don't know where, don't know how. As he said, I might have done it myself. I really would like to have interviewed this guy for 20 years ago. And this machine was built during the same time. And if you look at the specs, this is a hell of a lot of a faster machine. It's four times faster. I know 4 megahertz doesn't sound of much today, but if you're used to 1 megahertz, this is four times as much. And if you're used to a system with 48 kilobytes of memory, this one goes up to 128 kilobytes of memory. The ROM is not included in that. We have ROM on top of that. And on top of that, it's all built into one machine. That would be 8 more years until ICL would catch up to this. So he got it right the second time at least. So I'm probably going to go into a bit about Bokica data systems. That means Bokica. Bokica doesn't mean anything. Data systems. That was the young guys who sold it. And that's a story as well, but I'm not going to get into that yet because I collected a lot of materials about it, but I haven't read it yet. I'm not kidding. I have an entire shelf, one entire IKEA shelf filled with binders and books and photocopies and hardware. Actually, I have like a room full of hardware, but yeah, I have a lot of material and I haven't gone through it all yet. Anyway, this machine was was being traded for the next 8 years, more or less without modifications, and it could keep up with ICL, which at this point in time was like the Schultz International. It was the IBM of Europe. ICL had to improve, so HH Electronics and ICL kept on developing. As you see now, they got up to 4 megahertz as well and 64 kilobytes of memory. They also managed to put in up to 1 megabyte of memory in this machine if you were very rich. One application of this was that it was used for drawing, for CAD diagrams, and you could add up to 1 megabyte of memory into it. And they had a requirement that it should be able to contain the entire drawings of the Concorde plane, and that took up 1 megabyte of memory. And I think it was about 120,000 Danish kroners for that megabyte of memory. That was insane. And by the way, my dad did that software, so he had like memory for 120,000 kroners in his computer. I don't know if we had an insurance for that, but yeah. That was when I connected with his computers, because when I was like yay big, my dad worked on one of these machines, and it has intrigued me ever since. I never really get to play with it until I got like much older. Well, that's not true. When I was yay big, I get to like, I'm working on the computer, because this keyboard was made of, again, sheet metal. If something would break by me using that, it would be me breaking. The computer would not. That was for sure. This machine, line of machines, supported hard drives as one of the first in this series. So this was more or less the final iteration of the ICL Comets, at least in the early years. Well, that's not the final, but anyway, for now it's the final. But HS Electronics, they wanted to develop this further, and they realized that 8-bit computers and CPM was probably not going to outlive. It was obvious that it would be that the market would be troubled over by, among else, IBM. So they wanted to try to be better than the IBM. So they started developing something that I like really much. They started developing a Unix computer. Now we are back home again. We like Unix machines. So this was a 14 megahertz computer with 2 megabytes of memory and 12 megabytes of hard drive, which ran a full Unix system. Can you run anything on 12 megabytes today? Maybe even the Arduino development suite is larger than that. And this is actually about the same weight as the other computers, but there are more stuff in them. This was developed in unison with a Swedish company, which I'm still investigating. And I have a contact. I'm speaking with a few of the workers from over there, but I really don't have anything yet, but I suspect there's an entire chapter about this machine as well, and I have one of these machines. By the way, that's almost all the pictures I've taken myself, and I have, except from the Comet 2000, I actually have, either I or the Danish Museum have all the machines. This was sold to commerce schools. I don't know what they use them for. I still would like to find that out. But I actually think there's an entire book in this machine alone when I start digging through it. So I don't know what will show up, if anything. But the Butler machine, when he sold that, selling that in 1981, it was actually already prepared to do multi-user setups. So you would have one large machine with a floppy drive, and you would have five or six terminals that would all use the same printer and the same floppy drive. So it only took 5 years for ICL to catch up with that. So this machine contains a processor and some memory, and it wasn't a dumb terminal, it was a semi-intelligent terminal because it used the hard drive from the central computer, but it did all its calculations by itself. So I could load my program into memory and I could work on it all day without having to wait for the master computer, and I would have my own resources. That was a pretty clever move. I haven't looked into the pricing yet, but this was significantly cheaper, both because it only had four. These machines were built on something we call Euro cards, which is a print on that size, which has a standard connector, and you have like a row of circuits you can just slide them into, and all the connectors are just connected parallel in the entire way through. So you can put anything into that you want, and that's a good system because you can get these prints and the racks ready-made, and that's cheaper than building large prints. So this machine was actually pretty easy for them to develop because you just take the memory card, the CPU card, and then build a card for the remote storage, and then you could start producing these machines. So this was a cheap research and development process, and they now could sell more users per machine, and the schools could pay less for more workstations, which is a good argument when your competitors are selling machines for 150,000 krones that can be used by one person. Finally, we get to the ICL Comet MPS-8. So this is when ICL caught fully up to the Butler machine. This machine is more or less the same. Everything is built on one board, like on the Butler, and it has this memory switching, and then it had a pretty nice thing. It used a 1.45 megabyte floppy drive. I don't know if you know anything about CPM, but 1.44 megabyte of CPM software. You can almost have every conceivable piece of software made for a CPM machine on one floppy. And that one floppy is like 8 times faster than anything else this machine had ever seen. So this was a huge markup, a huge improvement. The machine also went from costing 30,000 krones a piece to 5,000 krones a piece. So this was really, really, really efficient. But also, you can repair it. I got one which is broken because the keyboard's LED has broken off, and you can repair it because the keyboard has been press-fitted and melted together. So this was the, I made a video about this. This was the last Danish 8-bit computer, and when I made the video, it worked. You can see that on the picture. It's filled of tantalite capacitor, so it's not working anymore. But we had it working for just a short while, and I'm of course going to fix it. So, but HS Electronics had realized that this PC thing will take over the market. So they actually stopped developing the machines themselves, and was like, I'm going to, they stopped the development and the sales process themselves, and started making PCs. Oh well, they tried. So they wanted to use Danish as an argument for buying PCs, and they made an expensive design cabinet and built the boards in Denmark and built everything in Denmark and tried to say this is so much better quality, but it wasn't because maybe the Chinese factory does it twice as bad, but they can make four in the time you make one. So I think I talked to the guy, he made 20 of them, so it wasn't really a thing. This is more or less the story. I'm going to finish off with a chapter where I'm going to quickly run through what happens. The IBM PC was launched in 1981, so more or less from the beginning they knew this was going to be over because IBM has already entered the market. In 1985, Mogens Pille bought the company which sold his machines. Børge Christensen died way, way too early in 1989. 1988, ICL Electronics just were like, we don't want to do this shit anymore, and started making, and hold on, you can't make this shit up, bike lights. The patented the first ever LED-based bike light and made a huge fuss about it. And when people asked them, oh, but that's the backlight, can we have the front light? And I said, no, we don't have white LEDs yet. They are not invented yet. So they sold backlights. But actually, they sold the patent to one of the Europe's largest producers of bike lights, Basta, I think they call. So it's in more or less being used today still. And then they started selling equipment for ships, and in 1989 they bought a plane, so somehow they made money. Unicomal, which was the last, ICL bought Regnecentralen, and Unicomal, which was the last company who actually produced Comal, closed down in 1993. 2002, Fujitsu acquired ICL, and 2019, the last known production software written in BASIC was taken out of commission. That was the chimney sweeper in a small town in Jutland who made this his own software in Comal that would take care of his business. Which customers am I to visit now, and who am I going to bill, and all that. He wrote that himself and used that until 2019. I think that's so awesome. Same year, Mike decided to write a book. Time for questions.
Thank you very much for this very interesting history talk. Are there questions?
So, hello. This Comal language was designed or inspired by Pascal. Why not go with just Pascal instead of BASIC?
So the reason why they didn't do that was that that Comal, have you tried working on a Commodore 64? Okay, when you have a Commodore 64 and nothing else, you just turn it on and you are in BASIC, bam. You write 10 and you write space and you write print hello world. Press enter and type run. Now you're a software developer, more or less. That is super easy and to teach to students. Let's try that in Pascal. Okay, now you need to start the computer and insert a floppy. Enter that floppy, start Poly Pascal. That's a keyboard combination for going from command mode into text, into insert mode. Now you need to write, use something. You need to use a library in order to print out to the screen. Then you have to write begin and end, and then write right line and hello world. Now you need to compile it. Now you need to exit your IDE and run that through the command line. Which one of those would you prefer to teach to ground school students? That was the argument. So they merged together Comal and Pascal and made an integrated development environment, and it got hugely popular. That's probably going to be written books about that in itself, but not by me. I have enough by this book. I think. Yeah. So until more questions come up, I can just. I'm most likely going to publish this book myself. So why is this not plugged in? No, okay. Apparently not important. I'm most likely going to publish this book myself. If any one of you think this is interesting, please go to my website and pre-order. And this is just a pre-order because you're essentially just signing up for a mailing list. And once I'm ready to sell the book, I'm going to write out and say, hey, give me money and I give you a book. And if you don't want to give me money, I'm not going to give you a book. So that's how it works. But I hope to raise some money so I can print some really nice books with hardcover and golden letters and make a really, really nice book. I hope so. It might just be a PDF, I don't know. Let's see. Any more questions? Thank you so much for listening. Oh, there was a question.
So these machines, they actually use Xilinx Z80 processors. but did that also mean that they were compatible with like abundance of software from like from Sinclair and stuff? Because there were lots of software back then for bookkeeping, and it was really compelling for people to actually buy one of those. But did it ever got a chance to run on these machines?
Can you repeat the last sentence?
Is it possible to run like Z80 software for the Sinclair on these machines?
So it runs CPM. So every piece of CPM software that's not dependent on special hardware will work. So every more or less every text-based piece of CPM software we had. We went to Berlin to the Vintage Festival, Vintage Computing Festival Berlin in 2019, and displayed one of the machines running Sorg. Sorg is a famous text adventure game, which was classical CPM game, and that runs on the machines. So yes. Which was, of course, a really important point, because you could tell the schools and you could just go and buy almost any kind of software except PC software, and that would run on it. Which was, of course, why it died later, because everything turned PC during the 90s. So.
Well, maybe a short question from me. On which hardware was this last COMOL software running?
On my laptop. It's still running. The software of Routinus we were just talking about, right? Yeah. Actually, that was the correct answer, because I got that software from him 3 months ago, and it's running on my laptop now. But he built it on this. Actually, this machine, the very first machine I showed you, belonged to one of his friends. Come on, you can do it. So I didn't tell you that, but this was a machine where you would buy it as a you would buy it as a kit. So the cabinet and the keyboard, everything was something the individual builder chose by himself. But this was a machine like that, ran the chimney sweeper software, and then the chimney sweeper upgraded to a machine like that one. No. Come on, that one, and had that for some years. And then, actually, the friend of the chimney sweeper, the priest from the same town, started writing software for ICL. So that will be part of the book as well. And then he got the larger one. And then during, I think it was 87, he said, he bought a 386 PC and switched to Unicomal and kept running his software there. And then just upgraded the computer all the way until he had something like a Core i something, which is insanely huge for a piece of software that could be run on an 8-bit machine with 64 kilobytes of memory. I like the irony of that. And the reason why he stopped using it was he retired and he couldn't get any more printers that would work with a printer port. So they went USB. So, yeah.
Okay, any further questions? Otherwise, let's thank the speaker again and